verses for you to read from.
Sure.
Does it shut off for you when you put the video?
I have to do it. I have already started it, and I'll turn things and everything. But before shutting it off, it'll be at the end of the service.
No, I mean, I was talking to him about the technology of doing it. So we're doing the same thing on the phone. We're like, dude, we ought to get a better camera, whatever we're looking for.
It's a fairly good camera. We had something going on, but we don't have it set up yet.
Well, he said that you have people calling and it stops it.
That was. I found out what to do.
Airplane mode.
Do not disturb and airplane mode. Airplane mode, but then you go down to do not disturb and click always. There's a section because I had it on airplane mode and still stopped.
Yeah, it really
to do not disturb.
So I use airplane mode. I record. I'll probably record just so I have a recording of it on my phone, just for audio. I do audio, and then I upload it to our website.
Yeah, I uploaded this morning my Sunday school lesson. Next week.
Well, for next week.
No, I didn't. For next week, it'll be live. I mean, not live, but I'll upload it after church. Today, I get a lesson in the office. Yeah, I've already uploaded that. Study it through Mark.
Take our hymnals, turn to number 96, and sing Angels from the Realms of Glory. Let's all stand. It'll be our opening hymn this morning. 96.
Right.
love to hear Christmas music. Amen. We're getting there. It's almost December. Let's remain standing for a word of prayer. I do have a special prayer request. We prayed for this last night, and that's for Norma's nephew. Mike Moon has a procedure tomorrow. It's called gamma radiation procedure. The men were describing that because actually Kirk's son had that many years ago. It's like a knife, a gamma knife. And so we'll be praying for him even right now, and we have. Father, I thank you that we could be here today, Lord. I thank you for helping those who have been struggling. I thank you that Heather is improving. We pray that you'll give her a complete recovery from her knee surgery. I pray for April this morning, Lord, having a lot of back pain. I pray that you would just strengthen her. But Lord, we do pray for Norma's nephew, Mike Moon, as he faces this intense procedure tomorrow on his brain. And I pray that it will be successful. Lord, your will be done. We pray that you will override and guide these surgeons and these technicians. And I pray that everything will go well. Lord, we thank you that the Potters can be with us today, Lord. We know it's probably been a very difficult Thanksgiving, but I'm glad they got to come and be with Harold and Helen. And we just pray for Harold and Helen in these difficult times, Lord. We pray for Ed and Barb as his time is running out. I pray that you would just strengthen the family and help them for the inevitable. Lord, thank you for the joy that we have in you, Lord. And we pray that you would just help us to worship you in spirit and in truth and rejoice in what you have done for us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. It is a joy to have Les and Denise Potter with us. And I forget your daughter's name. Forgive me.
Becca.
Wonderful to have you. And some of their children, other children, were able to come up and be here for the time they had with his dad and mom. And we just thank God for that. And they've been able to stay in our church house. And I know they're very appreciative of that. Their circumstances changed over there as Elizabeth's husband, Jim, built an addition for them. It doesn't have all the room that their old house used to have for you guys to stay in. So glad that you were able to use the church house for these several days. Here's a wonderful word I would like to share from Heather. And it says, "Dear Camp Lake family, thank you so much for all of your kindness and generosity during my surgery recovery. The meals, the visits, the words of encouragement mean the world to me. The flowers are beautiful, and offers to babysit Zachary have been amazing. I still have a great deal of pain, but God is so much stronger than any pain." Amen to that. Through it all, God is good. Love in Christ, Heather Carew. And we're just continuing to pray for you, Heather. Amen. All right, I'll save some of these other announcements. Let's sing some more.
Yeah, we're going to sing another Christmas carol, number 98. Infant, holy, infant, lowly, 98.
Christmas song. That's wonderful. It might not be new to my ears, but praise the Lord. Just want to mention several things from If you'll notice, your bulletin has an insert, and April prepared this. She is heading up the Ladies Heart and Home. It's entitled A Cozy Christmas. That's on Friday, December the 11th, so that's less than 2 weeks away, as the first is just a couple of days now. And so pray for this, ladies, and make sure you read this. You'll see that it says, please, it's called Cozy Christmas. Please join us for a relaxing, casual, and cozy night celebrating Christ's birth. In keeping with the theme, please wear a cozy Christmas sweater. Prizes will be given for the ugliest, the cutest, and the most creative sweaters. And food will be provided rather than having people bring anything. And there's no cooking exchange this year. It says, please bring a $5 unwrapped gift card for the exchange. And let April know. If you'll let her know, you can text her, let her know, calling, whatever. So that's coming up in less than 2 weeks. I know you ladies will enjoy it. We had to cancel the November one, and those are wonderful times for our ladies, these Heart and Home. We had a great time of prayer last night. I think we had 6 or 7 men in there, and we even got to meet someone new that came as the invitation of Kirk. So that was neat, plus Brother Les was there. A wonderful time of prayer. Don't forget, in the back, on the middle table, faith promise cards. Just want to remind you of faith promise. Be sure to look at that. Brother Chartier gave us these cards to use, and they're very well constructed. And if you haven't already, I hope you'll take a look at that. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, and I can't see the total. That's actually not what actually came in. Notice in your budget, $8,900 came in. A week before, it was a large amount. God is so good. Amen? Amen. Yeah, Ephesians 3:20 is kind of our theme around this church, because now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think. That's what God's been doing. And so we thank God for that. Also, another $10,000 came in specifically for the building project fund. So praise God. We're so thankful for that. Now, this Wednesday, we're picking things back up again. We're having a midweek service. We are not running. I was in error when I made the call about the van ministry. We are not starting up the van ministry until the first of the year. This has to do with COVID, and it has to do with the fact that these parents don't care and they'll send their kids sick. Even though we have our safeguards, it's just they're not having school, and that is a situation that we need to make sure we don't have the van ministry running until the first of the year. All right, and then I noticed that we will start up adult prayer and Bible study. We will be studying Isaiah 41, looking forward to that. And Mary's going to be, she's doing the Christmas story for the rest of this month with the ladies. Youth group and Heroes of the Bible are happening as well. There's a character rehearsal this coming Saturday for the Christmas program, and that's at 2 p.m. You say there's a Christmas program? Yes, there is. And I'm excited about it. I think it's going to be awesome. We'll get to that in just a minute. But they have a rehearsal for the characters. And if you have any questions, see Heather. And, of course, men's prayer meeting next Saturday night. And then the Ladies Heart and Home that I read to you on the insert. Notice it says on the 14th, John and Carol Gee are planning to see Esther Williams down in Florida right after Christmas. But they're willing to bring any gift cards or gifts that you may want to give her for her baby shower. And so we're thanking God that Esther's, Mary talked to her the other day. Her and David are doing very well. We sure miss her. She was a fixture around here for many years, and we're glad she's doing well. But I don't remember when she's due, but she's going to have a baby, and you see she's registered at Walmart. And these are some things that you need to read about, ladies. And John and Carol are heading down there, so they'll be taking some of these gifts. There is a Christmas program rehearsal on the 19th at 2 p.m. And then this is the Christmas program, the Not So Silent Night. Mark your calendars. It's time to laugh, sing, and capture the excitement and rejoicing of the night Jesus Christ was born. There will be no Sunday school or evening service that particular day. And come and discover what a blessed night that was, all right? Keep praying for Brother Jimmy up at Fort Faith. I know he's been having some eye problems, but this was a great praise. They had almost 300 people You got to go to that, didn't you, Pastor Mark?
Yeah, I brought some teenagers.
Fall festival. I heard that was very successful.
It looked very successful.
Wonderful numbers there. And so we're praising the Lord for that. And I don't know remember the numbers, but they had a good summer this year and a lot of people saved. And so in spite of different difficulties with his health, God's still blessing. Keep praying for Fort Faith. All right? Just a reminder about the offering. The offerings are in the back. We will be taking a loaf offering up at the end of the service today. All right? Pastor Mark, what's next?
Our hymn of greeting is next.
Our hymn of greeting is number 81. We'll be singing It Came Upon a Midnight Clear, 81. But before we do that, let's stand and greet one another this morning. And of course, keep in mind, if someone doesn't want to shake your hand, that's fine, okay? But let's all make everyone feel welcome this morning.
Good to have you back, Paul. Paul is back. He got back Wednesday. We're low this morning. There's Brother Les. He's going to be preaching this morning. That young man in the blue, his name is Dominic. Visitor that's been coming. We're glad to have him with us. We got some little babies here. Matthew's holding a baby. Michaela's holding her baby. Levante Lucas. And it's really good to have. If I can turn this far enough. It's so good to have Morrison and Broughton with us today. It's a real prayer. Praise. So keep praying for them. He's facing surgery. And he has a mass on a kidney. We're praying that it's not cancerous. Well, this thing won't hardly turn. Thank you.
share a song. Special number before the message today. Come on, sir.
Yes. Amen. Before I invite Brother Les to come up here, Vicki was sharing with me this morning that Pat LeBay has COVID and has been very sick, so we need to pray for her. That would be Alyssa's grandmother and Gil's mother, so we need to pray for her. And if you haven't heard, a local businessman in town, Gary Hosmer at the Sparta Sports Shop, succumbed to COVID. So we keep hearing of these cases and families going through things. Been over a couple of times this week to see Ed and Barb, and he's been given a terminal diagnosis, and hospice has been called in. So it's been difficult. And of course, Les's dad, Harold, I don't know. We don't know these things, how long he has, but we know God's in control. It was 20 years ago in March that Harold and Helen and I got on an airplane and flew to Israel. And I'll never forget that trip as long as I live. What an awesome, thank you guys for your hospitality and hosting us and all the things you did for us on that trip. We were touching on it a little bit last night, and I kind of like, I'm sure, like when a man, his eyes glaze over, and his ears kind of stop up when his wife starts talking. When I start talking about my Israel trip, that kind of happens to some other people. They get tired of hearing it. But I loved that trip, and it was awesome. And I want to thank you for making that so successful. Come on up, brother. We've supported Les and Denise for over two decades, probably about 23, 24 years. Not really sure of the timing, But so glad to have you with us this morning. We're praying for you guys. Thank you.
Bless you. Thank you so much. And we're so grateful. I'm so thankful for the friendship that Pastor Tyson is to our family. He led my dad to the Lord. I tell you, I never knew anyone that was more anti-church, more anti. I mean, my dad was very, very, did not like Christians. And somehow, Pastor Tyson got through. Of course, the Holy Spirit got through. But, I mean, he used the Pastor Tyson and through the discipleship. And so it was through that that my dad was saved. That was an amazing thing. And when we heard that, and he was going to get baptized. I mean, we came up at that time. I think we lived in South Carolina, and or Tennessee. I'm not sure where we lived at the time, but it's I was in Bible college, I think. So that, what a blessing that was. And so we're so grateful for the friendship down over the years and everything. And we'd love to do that Israel trip again. I've had, but of course you can't because of COVID now. But we have take other trip. People said, hey, could you? Would you like to go to Israel? And like, I mean, let me think about that a second. You know, sure. And so I've led a couple trips of people there, and it's more personal than what, it's not a Holy Land tour. It's not a, you know. So as I was sharing with you, one time we went and we were invited to a wedding, and it was just like, we're invited, like my whole group, we're invited like family. It was a big feast, and we just, you know, it was wonderful. And they thought, well, you know, we could never get this on a Holy Land trip, you know, like, so. I got to see an inside of Israel, and it's much cheaper too. I mean, it's much cheaper. You know, there's not, no one's making a profit off it. So it was like, it probably about half price. You
wow.
know? So it was what it cost us to rent a bus, and we use someone in the family over there, and he has a bus, and we use him, and so, and his other connections for places to stay, and it just all works out well. So I'm really grateful for the hospitality you have in your. Your house here, that's a real blessing to us. It allowed us to be able to come here and stay. And yeah, that surely is. We'll probably be having to return shortly. I don't know. I'd like to see my dad again before, you know, if possible. And so I'm thinking January or something like that, that we're thinking about coming back. But I'm so grateful for everything. And so with that, I'd like to... if you could turn to Habakkuk, the book of Habakkuk. Now, it's an unfamiliar book to a lot. It's you know, between Nahum and Zephaniah. And in my Bible, it's page 1171, Habakkuk chapter 3. I use the church Bible, that you know, the same, I think, Mark Chartier's, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Same, yeah. So, everyone in our church has those, so... occasionally, if I'm preaching out of a book that's unusual, and you know, that's like that, I can call out a page number. At least it'll get you close, you know. And but I want to do Habakkuk chapter 3, and starting with verse 17. I want to preach about thankfulness this morning. I'll joy in the Lord of my salvation.
Amen.
So, with that, let's. I'll begin here. I'm going to record myself here, and. I'm accustomed to doing that. So Habakkuk chapter number 3 and verse 17, it says, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet like hinds' feet, and He will make me to walk upon mine high places, to the chief singer on my stringed instruments. And so I'd like to bring a message this morning on I will joy in the Lord, in the God of my salvation. Let's start with a word of prayer, if we will. Lord, we're grateful to you for your blessings. We're thankful, Lord, for this church and for these dear friends. I just pray, Lord, you'd help me to be able to communicate as you'd have me to this morning, and that most importantly, every heart would be prepared, Lord, to receive, Lord, that which you have for us. And, Lord, that we would know your presence this morning and your joy, Lord. And I pray, Lord, you help us in this. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Habakkuk, is his name is kind of unusual. It's Habakkuk in Hebrew. It's kind of even strange sounding in Hebrew. I think it comes from Habak means to embrace, like a hug, you know. And so can you imagine naming your son
Habakkuk. I've never met anyone by that name, and for good reason. But he's the only one I know in the Bible by that name. But Habakkuk, as we pronounce his name. Now he prophesied after the time of King Josiah had been killed. Hmm. And if you remember some things about Josiah, he was a godly king, and he set about with all his might to cleanse Israel of idolatry. And there was a great time of revival there. He applied his leadership and to focus all Israel upon the Lord, all Judah upon the Lord. And he not only destroyed the altars of Baal, but he dug up the priest's bones and put them up as an abomination before all to see the stink of their sin. And I mean, these people were talking, they're digging deep and they're getting some things right. And that sometimes that's what it takes. Mm-hmm. In a society, that's in a nation that's gone so far against God, you got to dig deep and get it out. And with all those good things that he put in place, it looked like the nation of Judah was going to turn around and that they were going to go toward God. But Josiah got a little bit cocky with Pharaoh Necho II of Egypt, and he said, "Come, let's meet face to face." And so they, and even when Pharaoh Necho wanted to avoid it, they met face to face, and there Josiah was wounded in Megiddo, and he was taken back where he died. Now, you would think, though, after all what they had done, all the great revival, that you would think that in the things that he would have put in place, that this would have set the track for Israel to continue in the revival with this renewed desire for God and having confessed all their sin to get right. But as soon as Josiah died, the direction of the people went straight back to the very thing that destroyed them, that was bringing God's judgment upon them. And they forgot about following God, and they began once again to become enamored with dabbling with the very things that brought them to their demise, and which had brought judgment before, and that God had been blessing them while they're in, while they had been in revival. Now, there's something about idolatry. Idolatry is a lot like socialism. There's some kind of a pull for people, and that they can't. It's a pull. I don't know why. Some people, and it's even though regardless of truth and consequences, somehow this idolatry is different than the other. We always think this one, this brand of socialism is always, ours is different. Yeah. I know it's never worked before, but this one will, okay? And just like idolatry, and I wrote a book, not to put a plug up, but it's free to anyone who would like it. I gave you a couple copies on idolatry. You'd be surprised. We all think of idolatry, yeah, that's when you idolize some vehicle or something that you like, but honestly, the first commandment is, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Any kind of spiritual issue, when you put anything alongside God, and it's often in the name of God, something very good, that will lead you on a fast track to idolatry. It's spiritual. It's a spiritual. The book is called Nehushtan. And if that's not part of my sermon this morning, but the Nehushtan, if you remember, Hezekiah, in his time when they had a revival, that Nehushtan was that brazen serpent, which Moses made, and they lifted up in the wilderness, and it look and live. They were all bitten. They'd been grumbling, and God sent serpents among the people, but he made a brazen serpent. They can look and live. It's a type of Christ, a very good thing. In fact, the Lord even used that when talking to Nicodemus about as the serpent, Moses lifted the serpent in the wilderness, also the Son of Man. And so it's a very good thing, and that had been with Israel for 700 years. I mean, 700 years have been told that. I mean, it's a very good landmark, a very good memorial. But they had it in the temple, and they're burning incense to it. Mm. Hezekiah said, during their revival, he said, it's a piece of brass. Mm-hmm. Break, that's what Nehushtan means, is piece of brass. Break it up and get it out of here. A 700-year-old relic of a good thing that was, but you know what? It was being, it became an idol. Mm-hmm. And we oftentimes, you think, well, Baptists wouldn't do that, would they? Well, Baptists do, and you any good thing, you name it, and we know that Baptist history is a very good thing. It's very edifying for us to learn, but there's people that go so far into some of those things that it becomes alongside, they bring it alongside, and it begins to track them off of what God's word is. It's an idol. It becomes an idol. So anyway, that's free. I just threw that in as an extra there, but if you care to go about it, I'd be happy to give it to you. And so the chapter here in Habakkuk is a psalm. You notice at the end, he said it was to the chief singer upon
my stringed instruments. And so, in the beginning of the psalm, if you'll, let me see, where does it say, verse 19 there, and he said it was upon, let me see, walk upon the, I'm looking for my, where he said it was in Shigianoah, that's where he called it, that's an instrument. Psalm 7, it's to be sung upon Shigianoah, but in Psalm 7 is the same thing, it's the same place where the instrument is named. And it's only two places where that's named. Evidently, it's an instrument or the way it's played. But both of them, Psalm 7 and both in this, are both in a negative, kind of a negative consequence or situation and so on. And so the message of this chapter in itself is here is somebody that's looking at the spiritual condition of his nation. He's looking at it factually. He's not pulling punches or holding back on anything here. And he can see a lot of turmoil that's coming to him. And he knows that judgment of God is coming on his nation that's going into apostasy. And it's confirmed that their direction is it's not turning back. And all these things he laments for during in the book of Habakkuk. He finds joy in the Lord, even where all this devastation that's about to come upon him, upon his nation. Now, I suppose it's really easy to have joy in the Lord while your nation is in great revival in your society. Everybody's loving God, serving God. Hey, we're digging up the bones of the old priests. They're tearing down the houses of the Sodomites and taking down the high places. Hey, man, what a refreshing thing with truth. I mean, people are getting right with God. That's the time to, boy, you can preach like the house is on fire, can't you?
Amen.
I mean, ooh, man, it's cool. That's good. Because the whole society's with it. And you can just be a little bit stronger than them. And, man, you can just spur it on. And that's true. Now, but yet we see here that Habakkuk, he took joy in the salvation of the Lord when the circumstances were bleak and they were the opposite. Now, this whole nation is now going the opposite direction. And so, you know, that's probably a test of true spirituality. But really, when you think about it, after all, God is above all this world. But whatever the situation is, still God is the same. He's on the throne. So that's where we find our joy and where we find our thankfulness. Amen. Now, we have read the book. And we know the end of the book. We know how this is going to end up here in our world. And so we've got a lot to be joyful over. Even regardless of what this world does, we have a lot to be joyful for and a lot to be thankful for. Amen.
Amen.
And that's what we need to focus on, because we lose focus a lot of that. Amen. And I confess, I forget this. I mean, I do. I get so, you get gloomy when you look at the way our society's going and the way things are plummeting so fast. Well, it's very much like this. And so we want to look, this morning, we want to look at the joy of the Lord and consider that. So Habakkuk says that although it all comes to destruction and all the things that we need just for life, yet I will rejoice in the Lord and I will join the God of my salvation. And that's my first point, is I will join the God of my salvation. You know, we're creatures of this sin-cursed world, and we tend to judge things by the limits of our own perception, and we can only just see so much. And that's natural, but as new creatures in Christ, in our newly conformed mind, we're being discipled to think biblically by the Lord. As we're following the Lord, He's discipling us to think biblically and not according to this world, and we have a new mind as we go. And that's not natural, that's spiritual. The natural mind doesn't see those things that go with it, the carnal man. So it's also natural to respond to our surroundings. And when things aren't going really as they should, sometimes we find it hard to be thankful. We don't think about thankfulness at that time. And we know that from God's revelation that there's much more to the picture. We know that. The Bible teaches us that. And more than what we can see. And you know something else? God's word also reveals to us that there are demonic forces. We do have an enemy. We do have, and we even know from God's word that there are hierarchies of satanic, of different powers and different strengths and have different ways of hindering and us and so on, and different levels. And you know, I think a lot of them, the trifles and troubles of our life, they're even involved with that, the trifling and the troubling spirits and so on, that keep us occupied, distracted from the things that are more important. You know, the Apostle Paul, he writes about how he had a messenger of Satan that came to buffet him. and that buffeted him, just to keep him humiliated. And can you imagine that? And yet he had victory over that, even while he had the messenger of Satan. Now that is true. I've not arrived there yet, by the way. If anyone has a secret to that one, I haven't gotten there. But and so the ability to be thankful in the joy and to find joy in the God of our salvation while battling that messenger of Satan, that's ultimate. We're creatures of time and space, and we live in a stressful world, and this is real reality here. I mean, we live in time and space, and we have things that we have to accomplish during a certain time, and we have certain space that we can do that in. And while oftentimes we can be swarmed by a number of things, devils or whatever, that would hinder us and so on. And I almost wonder sometimes if people who are not so adamant about being good stewards of time and space, I wonder if they're not so swarmed with the frustrations of the devil because they're not a target, right? Because that's not so important to them. And I wonder, maybe we'll find out someday in eternity, I almost wonder if sometimes those people are used as allies of the devil sometimes, to actually hinder things. But anyway, that one, someday we'll find out. But Habakkuk here, he may not have been dealing with the messenger of Satan, but he could see the handiwork of the devil, the influence of Satan on his society, right? And we can see it too in our own society. And so he was very troubled at the reality of it and made a conscious decision to rejoice in the God of his salvation, and that's where the source of joy comes from. Now, our ultimate source of joy and thanksgiving should come from what God has revealed to us in the person of Jesus Christ. And thankfulness is an expression of joy. And joy is not something that you can just find in ourselves. You're not going to just pull it out of your heart because it's not natural. Oh, lost people could have joy in certain things, but not the same joy. We're not talking about the same kind of spiritual joy. Being a fruit of the Spirit, this joy is something that comes from the Lord.
Amen.
And as we submit to the Spirit of God, it's evidenced by our fruit. And so there's a book that was written in the 1700s, and I've never read the book. So the book could be totally, for all I know, it could be terrible. I doubt it. But it's called A Serious Call to Devout and Holy Life. And it was written by a man named William Law back in the 1700s. So I've not read the book, but I have read a quote from it. And I think it's really worth quoting here. And he says this: would you know who is the greatest saint in the world? It's not he who prays most or fasts most. It's not he who gives most alms or is most eminent for temperance, chastity, or justice. But it is he who is always thankful to God, who wills everything that God wills, who receives everything as an instance of God's goodness, and has a heart always ready to praise God for it. Could you therefore work miracles? You cannot do more for yourself than to be of this thankful spirit, for it turns all that it touches into happiness. A good point. I think it's non-inspired writing, but I think that's pretty good edification there. Amen. Now, sometimes having that spirit of thankfulness requires grace enough to look past the things of our immediate, what we see, and look past it into the one who gives us, because a lot of things that we live in here, they clutter our vision.
Yeah,
it is really hard to see. That's where it takes grace to be able to see past that. And so it is very much a spiritual matter. So being thankful is the healthiest of all human emotions. And that's true not only spiritually, but also, physically and emotionally. Secular psychologists even acknowledge the positive effect of a thankfulness on the mind and what it does to people, on the human mind. And those who study the effects of stress on the human overall person, they've said that the attitude that produces more positive emotional energy, this is the attitude of gratefulness and thankfulness, than any other attitude in life. And so it's actually to our, of course, just our physical and emotional well-being that we're thankful. And when we're living under this cloud of troubles and uh, our vision, of course, as I mentioned, it becomes obscured at times from that which is important, but to both ourselves and our relationship with God, and so Habakkuk got the victory here. And so it comes by harnessing the grace of God, which God provides for us, and which the devil will always try to distract you from harnessing. But it's there. Now, so thankfulness is a command of the Lord. We're familiar. Psalm 100, in Thanksgiving time, we read that. Psalm 100, verse 4, says, be thankful unto him, bless his name. And so that's not something that's contingent upon circumstances. We're told as a church body that in the midst of turmoil outside the church, we're to look at a different source, and which reveals itself in peace as we're looking to God. I'll read Colossians 3:15, it says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. And so the church, even though, I mean, outside the church body, there may be all kinds of things going on, but you know what? As a church body, we can be thankful. God condemns the lack of thankfulness also. Romans chapter 1, verse 21, mm-hmm. because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, and became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. And there's a principle there, light, that when we don't follow the light that God's given us, we actually walk into darkness. And their heart was darkened because of this. 2 Timothy 3 and verse 1, it says, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful and unholy. And that just speaks of Christianity in the last days. And so there's something else I find interesting for me. I love language and stuff. And so the word blessing in Hebrew is beracha. And that is tied to the same root word as berak, which is your knee. And so the knee, as the knee is bent, you know, it's tied to that blessing and thankfulness. And that's where we, by the way, that's where we bow. We bow to the Lord. Amen. Thankfulness. And so it's implied in the humbling of ourselves and kneeling before him. And that's not just some Jewish thing or some Old Testament concept. Ephesians 1:3 says, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. And so it pleases God that we bless the Lord biblically. And we do this in devotion and our devotion to him. And recognizing the source, and you know, we are in agreement with him on his holiness and on what he says. And you know, we take sides with ourselves, or against ourselves, we take sides with the Lord. And what the Lord says, you know, the old saying, God says it, I agree, and therefore that's settled with it. It doesn't matter if you agree, it's still settled, right? Yeah. So it's only to our benefit that we actually agree with the Lord. And that's part of our discipleship, that we're not like this, be conformed to this world. So the second point I have is from verse 19. The Lord God is my strength. And so, believe it or not, that's something we always have to be reminded of.
Yes.
And on a regular basis, there's an awful lot that we accomplish in the power of the flesh. And sometimes, in ministry, there's things you have to do. You've got to get this done. And we start doing it in the power of the flesh. And that can be our biggest hindrance sometimes. When all else is favorable in the world, and sometimes it's our failures that actually bring us to this, like, oh, it reminds us that, you know what, we need to be doing in the Spirit and walking with the Lord on these things. In the case of Habakkuk, the floor fell out of his world. I mean, it's gone. And the society in which he lived they had shamefully forsook the Lord. And they were coming under the wrath of God. And this is the same God, though, that called Habakkuk to preach. He didn't just call Habakkuk to preach. He called Habakkuk to preach to those people who had now rejected God. Now, how about that one? Now, that's a hard field, right? You know, I don't know if a field that's not hard, but that's a difficult place. And there's no place, you know, there's something about going to a mission field where people haven't heard the gospel, and man, it's fresh and new, and people are, like, embracing it. And that's really encouraging. And I've talked to people who have taken mission trips and gone to places like Ecuador and so on. But when you go to a place where a society that has had God and has rejected God, I tell you what, it's bitter. They don't want anything to go to England sometime. England, we're sending missionaries there. I tell you, they had God one time. And when the sun never set under British Empire, and they were in every place, and the English language went every place, and they had missionaries in every place. And then back to back, the first time in history, two empires, world powers that spoke the same language are back to back, carrying the same Bible across the world and teaching. Of course, I'm sure, you know, people, missionaries that learn that language where they're at. But the point is that now it's like going to America. You go to places in America, and it's really New England. It's, they don't want anything to do with God. Wyoming's that way. Wyoming is a place full of, the people are conservative and they're godless. Mm. You go knocking on doors and they want you, you know, get off my porch. I know where your church is. If I ever wanted to go there, I'd have been there. That's how they are. They don't want God. They're conservative. They don't want the God of liberty, but they want liberty, you know. And that's just the way they are. They're very fiercely independent, and they're pretty much up front. They're, you know, in the South, when you go knock on doors, they say, yeah, I'll come out and visit you sometime, you know, thank you very much, you know. And they're lying. They're lying through their teeth, man. They're lying. They're not coming, you know. I knew there's one church in the, I can't remember what, I think it was in North Carolina. They had this thing, it's called a round to it. It was a round, round disc, and they gave it to people, because people said, yeah, when I get round to it, I'll come out to visit y'all, you know. And I said, well, here's your round to it. And look, you bring this token with you when you come. And it's kind of a spoof on the cultural thing. They're polite there, but it's the same thing. They're still not coming, you know. And in the beginning of Habakkuk, if you look in the very beginning of it, here's his complaint. This is where Habakkuk has come. In chapter 2, chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, he says, O Lord, how long shall I cry, and wilt thou not hear? Even cry out unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not save? Why dost thou show me iniquity, and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and these that raise up strife and contention. Therefore the law is slack, and judgment doth never go forth. For the wicked doth compass about the righteous, therefore wrong judgment proceedeth. And so our text that we read is at the end of the book. You see the difference in his spirit? He starts, he's being open with God. By the way, I think that's okay to do that. Mm-hmm. Lord, why? I mean, I'm human. I don't understand this. And he's complaining to the Lord about the all that's going on. But at the end, he gets beyond that. He gets the victory. He says, I will joy in the Lord of my strength, of my salvation, and that God is his strength. Now, when our world collapses and it's devastating, we cry out to God. We ask, Lord, why? When Habakkuk began his complaint, he's like, he's seeing the glory and the godliness of Judah going south. I mean, it is gone. It's going into shame and weakness. And that's devastating to anybody who's righteous, who loves the Lord, to see your society go as he was seeing it. And you can sense the desperation in Habakkuk while he's crying out to God. But that nation used its free will to turn against God. And you know what? God does not ever violate your free will. He won't. You know, we pray for people that, you know, God, would you save that person? And that's, you know, we do out of desperation, Lord, save them. But you know, God does not zap a nation and reprogram to now love him. You know, I mean, from the very beginning, there's free will. That's why God put the tree of the fruit of good and evil in the Garden of Eden. Because if Adam didn't choose to do good, then if you don't choose not to do evil, you can't choose to do good. God did not create robots. He wanted us to willingly love him of our own free will. And so that's why that tree had to be in the garden. Because while Adam was not eating of it, he was choosing not to, and therefore choosing God. Well, you know, you wonder, God, change America. Well, you know, America's, you know, we need to get right. We need to get right with God. And by God's grace, we can, if people begin to get right. But honestly, all of us have a free will. Mm-hmm. You know, we'd love to see God reprogram things. Oh, my goodness. But that would violate the very first thing that God instituted when he created man, mm-hmm. is that we have a free will. And really, that's enough. Anyone that sees their society going collapsing, anyone who loves God, that's it's a tragedy. And but through that tragedy, he came to realize that the joy of his strength was not in Judah, but the God of Judah.
Amen.
You know, it's far easier to serve God in a society, as I mentioned, that is more godly, you know, when the society is, at least it's not anti-God, you know, when you're in a society like that. You know, in the Bible Belt, it's historically usually easier to serve God in the Bible Belt, so-called. You know, it's actually much out here. You've got so many churches out here. Mm-hmm. I see a lot more Christians here and people that are outwardly Christian here in Michigan. And this isn't the Bible Belt. It's like the Bible Belt to Wyoming compares, you know, in that comparison. But you know, even like throughout the Bible, with the so-called Bible Belt, that'd be the Southeast. You know, there's people because there's a certain amount of respect people even have for preachers. Can you imagine that? And so much so that there's some people who even will presume a call because they desire that respect, and that doesn't last very long, by the way, in that society at all. But it's also easier to share your faith, and in that kind of setting. You know, when you and your family go out to eat, you go out to the Golden Corral in Tennessee or anywhere like that. Or I was shocked. I visited a friend in Oklahoma a couple years ago, and just the difference was just stark because I'd forgotten what it was like. Now, when you go out with your family and you go pray for over your meal before you eat, the people there will honor your prayer. I mean, there's people will, you know, and the waitress will bow their head if they happen to be there. In Wyoming, if you're praying with your family, you better look first to make sure she's gone or he's gone. Because while you're praying, they'll be tapping you on the shoulder. Do you want a refill? Do you want the water before you, you know? They don't even know what you're doing. Yeah. They have no idea. And we're at least in a society where people know what praying is, and they honor it. You know, I was visiting a friend in Oklahoma, and we were praying for our meal, and the waitress came up, and she was like this. She said, "Amen." And I'm like, wow, this is, man, you know, this is good, you know. That's great to serve God somewhere like here. You know, that gets you fired up, you know, just that little thing, you know. And so, very much, when you hand out tracts to work in a society like that, people there, they'll smile and thank you for your faithfulness. Ooh, man, I can't imagine. I challenge our people to hand out 3 tracts a week, no matter what, at least. We've got one guy that puts tracts everywhere. I say, just lose them. I mean, put them somewhere at the gas pump, anywhere, you know. And that's our outreach, major part of our outreach. And I get calls all the time from people. They found tracts in the books, in the bookstore. They found tracts in the diaper. When they bought diapers and stuff from Walmart. And they're upset at me. And the manager says, "Would you tell your people to quit putting tracks in the bread?" You know? And I'm like, I can't control what they're doing, you know? But I got one call from one. I had people call me up and they're just furious. Stay off. I'm like, don't ever send your people to my door again, you know? But I got one call from one person the whole time we've been doing this. And they happened to go to another church, and you know, in Casper somewhere, and they said, "Well, thank you that you did that." Well, that's great. I mean, that's a big, you know, thing. But it's so rare to find that. And I don't know where I got off on, you know. But here's the thing. That's a great place to serve God, but the spiritual pull, the gravity, goes the opposite way when you're in a place that doesn't love the Lord.
Right.
It really does. There's been preachers that come out to Wyoming, for example, and they come from the South and other places, and they hope to win Wyoming for God. And by the way, I'm all for that. And I hope I'd love for them to come out and show me how to do it, because I'm looking desperately how to do this, you know. And they're going to win Wyoming for God, and boy, they're all on fire. And it's not very long, you know, when they get out, society does not help them. No one gives them any special respect for being, "Oh, God bless you, you brought the gospel to us." No, they're not doing that, not at all. And so it goes the opposite. And after a while, like Jeremiah talks about the heath in the desert, that's just a prickly bush that's just barely clinging to life. And they're out there in the prairie, the windswept prairie, and you know, they're all alone. It's not long before they pull down the sign, close up shop, and they go to at least their circles, at least have some respect for the gospel or something, and they kick the dust off their feet when they were before, they're gonna win for God. You're fighting gravity, spiritual gravity, and it's different places. And I'm not doubting. I mean, we need churches everywhere. I mean, Amen. We need churches here. We need churches in the South. We really need them in Wyoming. Our people in our church, I wouldn't trade our people for anything, our little church, and it's a tiny church. I wouldn't trade for anything, but you know, and we are, they give generously. Anyone that's coming to Wyoming, if they'll come to plant a church in Wyoming, we've already determined how much we'll help them. If there's scripturally sound, and you know, we will not only help them physically, but we'll help them financially, and I mean sacrificially in a big way. Awesome. And if they'll come to Wyoming, you know, but we're all about church planting in America, and we support missions. You wouldn't believe what our people give to missions. They are, because they're thankful. I mean, God sent them a missionary. They're thankful for the church that we have. And I mean, we are very much a little, you know, in the middle of nowhere. And but they understand what we have, and they're grateful. And by that, they're willing to give to it. And so, anyway, Habakkuk here experienced that society turning back to God. And you know, they're unlike people that flee, they can flee back to the south, but there's no land of Goshen to flee from when you're in Judah, and Judah is crumbling. Our nation of America is imploding. We've turned against, we want God, oh, we love the liberty, but we don't want the God of liberty.
Yeah.
And the characteristic of mankind, fallen man, is oppression. We oppress man. That's why our forefathers of our nation set it up, our government, because they know that the character of human beings is to oppress. That's what we do. And governments oppress. And so we have all these safeguards to stop us from oppressing one another. And we're even managing to get around that. And so that's because we're a nation without God. We've turned, I'm not saying about us. I'm not, you know, you're the choir, okay? I'm saying outside, as overall, the nation here, our nation, that once thrived in liberty and there was a certain godliness, that's no, you know, there it's now there's antipathy toward God.
Yeah.
So the whole thing is, I'm talking about Habakkuk, he's not glorying in Judah. When Judah was glorious in the revival, it's like, you know, when you're, it's wonderful to be in a plane and you've got your safety, but when that plane is in a tailspin, you're no longer finding comfort in that plane.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Habakkuk was finding it in a higher plane and looking to God. And so it's as ridiculously simple as it may seem and as trite as it is, it's really not about us. It's not about our society. It's really, truly is really about God. I mean, yeah. That's really what it is. And we lose track of that. And there's a lot of men, people that go into ministry who, like I mentioned, we do much in the flesh a lot of times, and they achieve much by their natural ability. And when things happen, they get in a tailspin that it's hard to survive because they can no longer do according to their own natural ability. My last point is close and short, but is the last one is he makes hind feet for high places. Now, a hind is a deer, is a female deer. And in that part of the world, the deer is considered, is regarded highly for its agility and its grandeur. And so the heart is a male deer, as this appears in the King James Bible. But it's the same word in Hebrew, it's ayal. And there's people in Israel that name their sons ayal. And then a female, a girl, would be ayala. And this word is ayala. So it's a female deer in high places. And so the feet of a deer or a hind, they're sure and they're fast. They can put their back foot right exactly where their front foot was, and they're sure-footed. In the high places that Habakkuk speaks of, are places of safety and separation. And you know, there's just something very, like I mentioned, sure-footedness. You know, I've seen horses trip and fall, and boy, when they stand, when you're on them, that's no fun. I've never seen a deer tumble. Maybe someone has, but I've never seen a deer trip or trip, but the horses do, and we ride, we trust them, you know, when we're riding. But the idea of the high places, that's a matter of safety and separation from the valley. And the hind whom God places her feet in high places, she has a cloven foot. You know what? The cloven foot of a hind, of a deer, resembles that of a swine in the valley. You know, they're both cloven, right? There's a world of difference between the two, though. A world of difference. And so it should be with us if we're going to walk with God in high places. We're not like the swine in the valley. Amen? God didn't create us to be like that. And he gives us a sure-footedness because of thankfulness. And that gives you a confidence. Now, 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, "Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the Savior of his knowledge by us in every place." And so, and for this, we're thankful. We're thankful for what God has done for us. Regardless of what happens down in the valley, when you're there, you give thanks to God. And you know what? We give thanks to God, how about this, even when things are going well. We're always challenged to give thanks to God when things aren't going well. But how about when things are going well? You know what? We need to remember to be thankful during those times. And it's a habit, and it gives us sure-footedness. James 1:17 says, "For every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." It's the most natural thing for fallen flesh to complain and become bitter about the plain facts of life. And there are things that they're not nice in life. Honestly, there's things that are just not good. But in so doing, we cloud out the plain other truths of all the blessings of God. And we need to be reminded to focus on that which is above. And it's the altitude of gratitude, not just the attitude, but the altitude in high places. And I'm preaching to myself when I say these things. I really am. I truly am preaching to myself on this, because I have to be reminded of these things. And so the hardest thing is to realize that, you know, we don't always see the whole picture. And if you live long enough and you learn, you ever have things, if you look back when there are things that you absolutely lost your joy over, you were so troubled over it, and then, you know, fast forward later on past it, you really didn't see the whole picture. Mm-hmm. Well, and that's good. We learn from that, amen, until the next thing comes up, and then we're all anxious again and all full of anxiety and loss of joy. And it's a continuing thing. And this is a matter of faith and victory. And so having an understanding that we truly don't see the picture, but we do have a relationship and follow the faith of giving us to the one who does know the whole picture. And so a few verses here, 1 Thessalonians 5:18, "And everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." Ephesians 5:20, "Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." And so giving thanks to all for all things. It's when things are well, it helps us to ward off the blindness of when things cloud our lives. And likewise, when things are not so well, we take comfort. You know, David was careful in how that it was God that led him to the green pastures. Mm-hmm. It was God that led him to the still waters. And because it's God that's led him in those, he will fear no evil when he walks in the valley of the shadow of death. And so the thankfulness is the key for a saved child of God to rise with sure-footedness and as hinds feet. When that cloud of corruption just over our heads sometimes, we're looking at the things in our nation today and we become despondent over it. But you know what? We can be looking ahead of that and above it. Psalms 103:1 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all this within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget all his benefits." So anyway, I'm wrapping this up. But if you've never received the Lord, and if you don't truly know that you're saved, you really don't have this grace to be able to look beyond. Mm-hmm. This is not some Pollyanna type of thing, a religious thing, like, you know, let's just be glad. That's fake, by the way. That don't work. That doesn't last very long at all. But if you truly know the Lord, if you've received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you can say, "I will joy in the God of my salvation."
Amen.
And so it's important. Do you know you're saved? I preach this. I know every one of my people. I know their testimony. I know everything. But I still always bring up salvation. Do you Amen. Know you're saved? Are you sure you're saved? And I don't know all of you. And so there could be someone here that you might have some doubts. Well, you know what? This is the time. Don't walk out of here and put it off for another time. We'll give you a round to it, maybe, on the way out. No. Just don't do that, because you may not have another opportunity.
That's right.
And you come to your pastor and ask him and say, I just need to make sure to know that I'm saved. And so then you can say, I have joy. And if you do know you're saved, and if you can say beyond a shadow of a doubt you are, can you say that you're dwelling in that high place and that you can... We have moments. Everything's seasonal, but we have. But you know, when you have those high place of thankfulness, and we all find ourselves in a cloud at times. But that, I want to encourage you. That's just to edify and bring this to about. I'm going to turn it over. If you for a hymn of invitation or whatever.
Thank you, Brother Les. I really enjoyed that this morning. That was uplifting. Let's bow our heads right now. Let's stand. Father, thank you for this message from Brother Les in the book of Habakkuk. And Lord, I pray that each of us will joy in the God of our salvation, no matter what's happening in America, no matter what's happening around us. Lord, I thank you for the positive nature of this. It reminds me of Psalm 46, as though the earth be removed, we know you're still our God of refuge. And I pray, Father, if there is anyone here that does not know you as Savior, they can't have this kind of assurance. They can't have this kind of peace until they know you. And I pray, Father, if there is anyone that doesn't know you, that they'll get that taken care of today. Because we know 2 Corinthians 6 says, now is the accepted time. There's no putting it off. There's no promise of tomorrow. Now is the accepted time. Please bless this invitation, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Mark.